Now, you used to see a lot of scientific counsel within government. This is a common thing during most of my lifespan, offices of technology assessment and so forth. A lot of these guys cluttering up the scene in government. They are a dying breed. Because fundamentalists and oligarchs both despise science. They don't want anything to have, they won't have anything to do with them. Now, in this ancient standard of futurism, the gold standard is Vannevar Bush from the 1940s, who was one of the inventors of the atomic bomb, a master engineer of the Manhattan Project. He was also the father of the American National Science Foundation because he wrote the extremely important futurist text, Science, the Endless Frontier. That screed is probably the greatest work of futurism ever put onto paper with a typewriter. It's really an impressive governmental document, and you know, and aimed at the head of state. So there's still a problem with this. It's like, why isn't science as respected as it was? And I think the problem there is cultural. And because Americans, and especially Californians, have a severe moral problem with the idea that frontiers end, that they're not endless. In fact, that gold rushes just get old and die ugly. They're not always young and pretty and beautiful and glamorous and forward-looking. They get old and cranky and weird, you know, and like obsessed with themselves and kind of like move from, you know, from savagery to barbarism without civilization ever occurring. Savagery, barbarism to decadence without a civilization is a typical frontier development. So, you know, to think that the science is an endless frontier is actually a bad paradigm, especially for a futurist or a scientist. For instance, paleontology is an important science, which is about things that ended a long time ago. And they're just ended. They're not gone. They're not going to revive. You're not going to improve the trilobites, right? But it's important to understand what's going on in geologic time, whether there's anything to do with it or not. And there are also many areas of scientific investigation that are not endless frontiers, they're dead ends. I mean, they're cul-de-sacs. They have to be abandoned, such as phlogiston, you know, or the luminiferous ether, or spontaneous generation, or even some aspects of Newtonian physics. I mean, they're not up to speed, and you know, you have to let those go. Scientific truth is provisional. It's not permanent and eternal. And science as a human enterprise, I mean, the actual business of science and like how scientists are recruited, promoted, how they quote one another, that's a very time-bound, very social kind of situation that changes quite a lot as time goes on. So if you think that atomic physics, or maybe the truth of atomic physics, the scientific truth of atomic physics, is somehow an eternal thing, then you have to go all out for nuclear power or giant gadgets like the superconducting supercollider, which is unwise. I mean, that ambition is going to end in tears. If you ask the government for $11 billion for a superb scientific instrument that is not going to work, it's just, you know, it can't be built. That is bad politics. It's poor statesmanship. You're a scientific futurist, but you gave bad advice. So if you're a scientific futurist and you're in the government pace layer, you can't simply say to them, I have some inconvenient truth here, look at this math. It won't work. You have to say, I have some inconvenient truth here and I can use it to win World War II with a secret super weapon. That was the Vannevar Bush method. That's what life is like in the government pace layer when things are really cracking right along.